the cactus forest of Arizona. It's also developed defense strategies. The water it conserves is highly valuable. Those who mess with the cacti bear the marks for a long time, like these peccaries. Choya sprigs hang from their coats like limpets, and it's painful. The peccaries can only get rid of the burrs when they drop off by themselves. Then the sprigs start to grow again where they lie. In this way, the sprigs do double duty. Apart from the cactus fruit, there's very little moisture around here. The animals have to put up with the prickles. Squirrels have developed their very own harvesting technique to deal with the barbed plants. Success is obviously worth the pain. And one can always take a nice dusty bath afterwards to get rid of any remaining thorns. On the other side of the world, some others have also managed to outsmart the plants to secure their place in the woods. Koalas in Australia. Eucalyptus leaves are poisonous. This is how the tree protects itself against enemies. No large animals can eat them, apart from koalas. They can do this thanks to special digestive bacteria that they use to exploit the leaves. A baby koala cannot manage this right from birth. It first has to acquire the bacteria from its parents. The trick only works with individual leaves from specific types of eucalyptus, ones that don't contain too much poison. With this ability, the koalas have secured themselves a food source, unchallenged by large competitors. Plants and animals in the woods have a close relationship with many interdependencies. If the plants develop a strategy, the animals will respond, and vice versa. This is how the forest system largely maintains equilibrium. The forest by night is regarded as secretive and mystical. For a long time, no one really knew what trees do at night. It was only known that plants also have a day and night rhythm. After all, if flowers are placed in a dark cellar, they still open and close, as if they were outside. Charles Darwin discovered that plants let their stems and leaves droop at night and referred to it as sleep. Only recently have scientists detected this behaviour in trees as well. 5-metre birch trees let their branches hang down by up to 10 centimetres. The deepest point is reached just before sunrise. This could be caused by the stoppage of water processing overnight. Photosynthesis requires light, of course, and so no water is needed at night to create sugar solution for energy. The leaf pores are left open, however, The tree still has to breathe, so it still needs oxygen. But at night, the oxygen is not self-produced, and so the tree has to extract it from the environment. In return, the tree exhales carbon dioxide. On balance, though, a tree generates so much oxygen that this reverse process is of hardly any consequence. And the trees appear to heavily depend on their sleep. According to research in the United States, trees apparently died after being exposed to light from street lamps. Even when the trees are asleep, the forest itself is always active. A pygmy owl has caught some prey. Around a third of all vertebrates are nocturnal. With invertebrates, it's almost two-thirds. They also help to ensure that the forest system runs smoothly. The equilibrium of the forest depends on many factors: light and air and water. And also on the number of herbivores. Too many of them can cause damage. Predators often take on the responsibility of managing their numbers. But even in forests without predators, a balance is maintained. Terrestrial predators like rats and cats were first brought into New Zealand by human settlers. Before that, the forest animals had no enemies. Many birds live close to the ground, like the kakapo. It's the only parrot in the world unable to fly and nests on the ground. The chicks and eggs are easy prey, not least for weasels and ferrets. Farmers introduced them in New Zealand because a plague of rabbits had been brought into the country. In conservation areas, the number of kakapos is steadily increasing. Around 150 of them are thriving today. Even the national symbol of New Zealand, the kiwi, is under threat. At night, the forest dweller dares to venture out. The bird is an omnivore. It has a special ability, however, in detecting the movement of worms and larvae underground and picking them out with its long beak. Birds were once the biggest plant eaters on the islands here. Apart from a few types of bat, there were no mammals or marsupials in the country. So that the woods could maintain their balance, the birds only had to keep the herbivorous insects at bay. Even in places where land predators have been present all along, they don't always correspond to their reputations. In the mountain forests of northern Spain, brown bears wander the slopes. They don't keep the number of herbivores in check because they mostly eat plants themselves. In Sweden, scientists have determined exact numbers. Bears there cover around half of their yearly food requirement by consuming berries. Around a third is made up of plants and insects, and only a fifth of large herbivores. Only seldom do bears prey on adult moose. Normally, it's the calves they kill. And not every meat-based meal in the statistics has been killed by the bears themselves. They'll also make do with moose that have already died. They even jostle with wolves for the privilege. In Europe, the wolf should be seen as a welcome homecomer. They're the only animals capable of truly restricting the number of deer. Wherever wolves are found, browsing damage in the forests is controlled. So they really do work towards an equal balance. Sometimes, however, a wolf will leave the woods to hunt. They only need the trees during daytime to hide from humans. In contrast to the wolves, there are predators who have perfectly adapted to the woodland environment and who will only hunt in the forest. In Europe, that means the lynx. They lie in ambush until their prey is close enough. In South America, the jaguar follows the same tactic. He can only prowl close enough to the caimans by staying under cover. Then he has to wait. Jaguar and lynx could only develop as ambush predators thanks to the cover of the forests. The forest is the ideal place for all those who need to keep hidden. The red deer has noticed the lynx and makes off, while the caimans are now within the jaguar's reach. He's still invisible to them, however. And the roe deer is also too late in its detection of the lynx. A life and death struggle begins for the jaguar, while the lynx has already emerged victorious. The jaguar does eventually also kill his prey, albeit in an alien environment. Both lynx and jaguar depend on the woods for hiding places, in keeping with their hunting strategies. Other animals hide away in the trees in order not to be eaten. Camouflage is the key to their survival. But the hunters also know the tricks. Australia's death adder creates a fake worm with its tail, an ingenious trap for prey. And the trick works. In the modern world, the forest is often the last sanctuary away from human beings. At night, though, many animals dare to emerge from their hideouts. In daytime, it's not only the wolves that withdraw back into the woodland. Red deer were not originally forest dwellers. As grass eaters, they lived in the open landscape. In Scotland, these creatures are moving back to their earlier lifestyles, even though they're still being hunted. They don't have any other choice now that the forests are gone. While humankind has hunted many species to extinction, there's always a surprise or two still in store. Deep in the forest, where humans couldn't venture, something survived. This is the first footage of cross-river gorillas. Until the end of the 1980s, scientists believed this subspecies of western gorilla to be extinct. Even today, they're hard to find. Around 250 of them still live in the borderlands between Nigeria and Cameroon. Florida forests also harbor the last of a kind. The Florida panther, a subspecies of puma. Camera traps deliver the few images from the wilderness. In 1970, only 20 animals were still living here. Today, however, it's around 150. The forest is often the last refuge for animals. In the national parks of Africa, lions normally live in the savannah. They've nothing to fear and show themselves openly. Even if they start out cute and cuddly, they grow into the biggest terrestrial predators on the continent. In Ethiopia, on the other hand, the king of the animals occasionally lives as a recluse, high up in the mountain rainforest. The jungle lions were first photographed in 2012 and finally filmed in 2015. As far as experts know, these are the only lions living in a rainforest. They're probably just passing through, but more research is necessary to find out further details. In the forests of Australia, one can also find some rather unexpected animals. Everyone knows the red kangaroo, yet these animals only evolved after Australia's rainforests had declined, and when animals thus had to cover wide distances to find food. Where the rainforest still thrives in Australia today, a much older type of kangaroo can be found. High up in the branches, the tree kangaroo nibbles on leaves and raises its offspring, constantly in danger of the young animals falling down. But there's always food available. This kangaroo never has to learn how to take giant leaps. Much more important are the strong claws that allow the animals to hold on to the tree trunks and that also help to prevent the infants from falling off. Once a species has become adapted to life in the forest, they die off if the woodland disappears. In Scotland, the capercaillie is struggling for survival. The pitiful remains of the Caledonian forest are not sufficient to support their population. Scottish wildcats are also on the wane. Hardly 100 animals remain in the Highlands today. They're similar in appearance to European wildcats, but they're so uncommon that no film footage of them exists. The biggest problem of the Highland tigers, as they're lovingly referred to, is stray domestic cats with whom they mate. In this way, their species could soon disappear, absorbed into the large gene pool of the house cats. Significant biodiversity can only be found in parts of Europe where unspoiled woodland is still growing. The rare stag beetle lives on oak trees. Its larvae needs rotten deadwood, while the beetle itself feeds almost exclusively on oak tree sap. Even hornets can't put him off. Only when he meets a competitor do things get serious. The two beetles fight for the right to mate with the females on the tree. He who falls off has lost, and the victor claims his bride. Virtually everywhere on the planet, the life of the forest is determined by the seasons. They dictate fixed appointments for the forest, since day length is more decisive than pure temperature, and because day length changes at the same time each year. An equality of day and night marks the start of autumn. At this point, day and night are each 12 hours long, all over the world. Afterwards, the days become shorter than the nights. As soon as the trees get too little light, their leaves begin to change colour. Thus, the cosmos decides what happens in the forest. color display of the autumn leaves is beautiful. But beauty is not the main purpose. There is a practical reason for the show. Water is vaporized via the leaves of deciduous trees. Only in this way can the suction system be maintained that draws water up to the leaves from the roots. In winter, this doesn't work, since the water in the ground is frozen, and the roots cannot maintain supplies when the water is evaporating through the leaves. The tree would dry out. That's why the tree seals off the connection between branches and leaves. Without water, the leaves will quickly dry out and drop off. But wait, before the tree cuts off the path to the leaves, it extracts their most valuable element, chlorophyll. That must not be wasted. While the green chlorophyll is taken out, other substances become visible that were previously hidden beneath it. One of them is the orange-yellow carotenoid. Everyone knows it. It's the stuff that gives carrots their distinctive colour. On some trees, the leaves even become red or violet. In these cases, it's anthocyanin left behind. That gives cherries, grapes, and red cabbage their colour. Finally, the wind dries the leaves out. The tree remains well protected, falling into a state of winter rest, until the temperatures rise again and the days become longer. Forests have left their mark on the face of the planet for millions of years. It's astonishing how they have managed to spread to almost all corners of the Earth. Even where one least expects it, the trees have sent out scouts and gained a foothold. On the rock pinnacles of Saxon Switzerland, the forest makes use of every crack that's gathered a bit of earth over the years. A tree can then grow as a vanguard, breathtaking. In Yosemite National Park, woodland has grown over a rocky landscape, a formidable achievement. Beneath a thin layer of earth, there's nothing but stone, piled up by the erosion of the mountains. On the coasts, where forest meets salt water, it's exposed to an aggressive climate. With the low salt content of the Baltic Sea, however, some indigenous trees get along for a while. They've managed to fight their way to the flood mark. Even defying the sand. Until it finally swallows them up. But a forest never gives up. In the subtropics, it has even grown into the mudflats. And wherever it spreads, its inhabitants follow. Even north of the polar circle. For us humans, the forests are essential for our survival. Wherever they grow, they produce oxygen. Yet humans continue to destroy woodland. We lose 90 square kilometers of it worldwide every day. Faced with this situation, it doesn't even matter that dwarf birch trees have managed to establish themselves beyond the tree line. The forest is incredibly resistant. If it's driven back, it always finds ways to spread out once again. Many elements in the woods combine to create a unity. Be it animal or plant, everything unwittingly takes on a role that contributes to the functioning of the whole system. If the forest's environment changes, its occupants will likewise alter themselves, but the woodland itself remains in perfect balance. It's adapted over millions of years to climate and weather. The forest has managed to win through. Does that mean it's a living organism? The cooperation of its many parts does not follow a prescribed goal. It rather seems to be guided by coincidence. All the same, it has turned the forest into perhaps the most successful ecosystem on Earth. A system we have a duty to protect.